Jackie.
Hi. Do you know what's happening now?
Yeah.
Yes?
Are you from Hong Kong?
Yes, I'm from Hong Kong.
Yeah.
And also, it's like many of my friends, they're not trying to walk about the street and have a very peaceful protest. That's to show that the government that they really want a real democracy rather than the Chinese government will just randomly take three person, have to build a bus, and then we can only vote within that government.
Yeah, so,
that's what I heard. Do you
want to deal with it? Yeah, oh, sure.
Yeah, here, one
okay.
for you.
Okay.
And
thank you. Okay.
Do you want to take a photo to show that the first real group of all the photos to be a giant photo?
Yeah, well, this is a video, making video. And so it's going to be on YouTube.
Okay.
A couple of days, looking for Black Horse Media.
Okay.
I did the free speech movement also in the protest. So you'll see. So yeah, just go on YouTube, Black Horse Media, and you guys will be there also. And okay.
Oh, the first time I've had a match up.
For free speech and political advocacy, Dolores Huerta. This wonderful, wonderful commemoration. God knows it's so desperately needed. And thank all of you who made history, that are here, that came here. I know we all have to go to this day to be here. And really, you are really blessed people, and you were, you know, the vanguard author in that journey to bring civil rights issues and the peace and a peace speech to everybody. And, you know, one of the reasons I think, and I'm just going to, you know, this is an assumption, the one thing that the powers that be really, really hate and really, really fear is when they see us coming together, right? They don't want that. They don't want that. They would prefer that each of us work in our own movements and our own silos because we know that the jobs that we're all trying to do, the justice that we're trying to bring, is so much harder that way. So this movement started because of the civil rights movement in the South, because people wanted to help the people that were out there in the South just trying to get the right to vote. I have here with me Walter Riley. He is a civil rights attorney here in the Bay Area. Walter was actually in court. He was there in the South. Maybe you could say a couple of words that you guys were doing. I think we have something to do with all this.
Okay. Very quick. I'm not scared. Dolores brought me up. I was a field secretary. I was a field secretary for the Congress of Racial Equality at the time of the free speech movement in the Southeast region. In the Southeast region of the United States, we did voter registration and employment campaigns, integration campaigns. But what is important today is for us to remember some of the things, like the connection between Ferguson and the streets of Oakland and Berkeley. We need to understand that today that there is this ongoing fight. This is not a nostalgia moment for us. This is a continuation of the struggles that we've always been part of, and we just have to intensify our commitment to making the change in this country that has to occur. Thank you.
As Walter said, you all started the journey here, but we know that journey is not finished. You know, we are still traveling that path to try to get to justice and try to get justice for everyone. And as Walter said, we cannot, you know, rest when we know that we still have so many of our young people that are getting killed. When the lynching of African Americans and young Latinos is done by the police, so that is going on right now. You know, we have to remember that. We have to see if we can stop it. And right, you know, attacking labor. They want to, you know, keep people distracted, because when you come right down to it, the real issue is the economy, right?
Yeah.
It's the economy. When you have that 1% that have more wealth than the 99%, when you have 400 families that have more money than 1,500,000 people here in the United States of America, and this is totally, totally wrong. I see the students behind me. What does this sign say? Free education. There is no reason why we, the richest country in the world, should not have a free education for every single person in America. you know, there's no other country that has an economic blockade, and they can have a free medical education, free university education, free health services for all of their citizens, then why in the heck cannot the United States have the same thing, right? Why can we not have the same thing here? And the other issue, I was on the Regents Board of the University of California here for a short while. Schwarzenegger did not reappoint me. But when I was on that board, I was like the only working class person there. So we want to change the university. This university is not doing what it should be doing for its people here. This is a state university. It was originally made to serve the public here, right? Not the people that have a lot of money. It was meant to serve the public, and we've got to take it back there. And I would like to suggest that maybe we'll get one of our legislators to say, we want to introduce a bill in Sacramento that at least half of the Board of Regents come from labor, come from working class people, and just stop appointing all these millionaires to the board, right? So what you fought for, we can still make it a reality. Whether they have referees, they have the right to organize, they have unemployment insurance, right? You know that there's only two states in the whole United States of America that have that, California and Hawaii. New York State is still trying to get those rights that you helped us get for farm workers 40 years ago. So we know how to do it. All of us are here, gathered here. We just got to continue to go out there and organize. You know, we cannot stop, we cannot take a breath. I'm 84 years old, everybody. Okay? We cannot afford to retire. We've got too much work to do. You know, we've got to preserve our planet. You know, these idiots that don't think there's any climate change is going on. And bring our children and our grandchildren and everybody that we can. We've got elections coming up in November. Don't forget to vote, and please vote yes on Proposition 47. Okay? What is that? Proposition 47 will reduce the felonies to misdemeanors to get some of our kids out of jail, all right? It will be retroactive to get them out of jail. Proposition 45, what is that? It will say that these insurance companies, these health insurance companies, cannot raise their rates until they get the approval from the insurance commissioner, okay? So we have a lot of work to do, and I just want to close by, let's remember the people that did the work for us here, okay? So I'm going to say, for those who were here with us before and they've now left us, so I'm going to say, Mario Fabio, now I want all of you to say, presente, like you're here today with us, okay? Really, really loud. Mario Fabio!
Presente!
Cesar Chavez!
Presente!
Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Presente!
Father Bill O'Donnell!
Presente!
Dorothy Day!
Presente!
Can we out there? Can we do it? I think we have the troops here. We got the energy. We got the will. And yes, we will make it happen. Se puede o no se puede?
Yeah.
And Obama says, yes, we can. In Spanish, it's si se puede. Let's all do it together. Let's go.
Si se puede. Si se puede. Si se puede. Si se puede.
Okay, I want to introduce you to you now one of the important people from the free speech movement. She was one of the first people to get suspended for, passing out leaflets. She later became a state assemblywoman in California, and now works at UCLA in the social justice teacher education program. She spends her life with dedication to education in the state of California as well as other issues. Jackie Goldberg. Well, I can't tell you how wonderful it is to see a crowd in Sproul Hall. Anniversary.
old. I don't know what happened to those 50 years. They just went quickly, didn't they? Everybody here who was in the Berkeley Free Speech Movement in 1964, raise your hand.
Yes.
You know, that tells you something. It tells you that we built a community. That people want to see each other after 50 years is because we built a community. We built a community from the left, from the right, from the center. Democrats, Republicans, communists, socialists, reactionaries, libertarians, all came together around one idea. That a person does not lose their rights as citizens of the United States when they come onto the campus of the University of California. Many of us have been involved in movements all our lives since that date. And I'm just going to name a few, and if you've been involved in it, raise your hand. The Civil Rights Movement. All right, how about women's reproductive and abortion rights? LGBT, the lesbian, gay, and bisexual, and transgender rights. Anti-war, anti-imperialism, anti-Vietnam fights. Labor union struggles. And women's liberation. Why, how can I forget that one? Oh my God, I could get clobbered. Why were we in all of those movements? Why are we still involved? We are still involved because the repression from the right has been greater than we expected. We didn't know that they were going to steal everything that wasn't nailed down. And when they finished that, they were going to steal everything after prying it up that was nailed down. We didn't know they were going to take that wealth and decide that students would ever come out of debt in the tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars to get an education. We didn't know they were going to say that people don't need labor unions, don't need pensions. We didn't know those things. So we have to stay fighting. But I'm hopeful. Why am I hopeful? Look at the people behind me. That's where I'm going. You're why I'm hopeful. I'm hopeful because you know. You know that the forces of evil are small in number, and we are many. We are many. We are many. And if we can do those kinds of community-building things, cross lines of ideology, cross lines of practice, cross lines of social movements, if we can do that, if we can build community, we can change this country into a democracy. Will be not only a political democracy, it will be an economic democracy as well. So here's what I say to you. I know it's terrible. I didn't listen to advice of people then, but I'm going to give you a little advice anyway. Listen, not just talk, when you're organizing. Listen, not just talk. Make sure that you reach out and support each other's efforts, not just the ones you are personally in. And here's the most important. Every morning, get up and look in the mirror. And as you're brushing those dentures, say to yourself, I will not be cynical today. I will not be cynical today. I will not believe the crap that everybody is in it for themselves. I will not believe that everybody is corrupt. I will not believe the propaganda that is designed to make me think it is hopeless. It is never hopeless as long as you resist. Thanks, Jackie. Next speaker will be the distinguished professor of feminist studies at UCSC, and maybe her more important title, steering committee member during the FSM, Bettina Aptheker. Thank you so much. It is a joy to be here today. I share Jackie Goldberg's optimism and Dolores Huerta's beautiful words. And I was thrilled as I entered Sproul Hall Plaza to see all of those tables up
of the civil rights movement of the 1960s. Coming out of Mississippi, coming out of protests in San Francisco, it's already been said, I'm not going to dwell on it, but I want to emphasize that. It was the black students in the South, the black sharecroppers in the South, the black church women in the South who rose the country up. That Martin Luther King Jr. then appropriately claimed, but never forget where the real impetus for that movement came from and then helped us here on this campus. One of the key things we learned in that movement was the power of mass movements and coalitions. And it was through that, including the labor movement in this area, the farm workers of which Dolores Huerta was a leader with the Chavez, it was through that and the civil rights coalitions here in the Bay Area, and then the faculty on December 8th that finally broke the back of the regents and the governor and forced them to recognize that they would not go beyond the First and 14th Amendments to the United States Constitution, and that they would guarantee freedom of speech and equal opportunity before the law. I also today take great inspiration from the tens of thousands of folks that filled the streets of Manhattan 10 days ago as the United Nations commenced the liberation of climate change. What a demonstration of people's power that was, starting with Indigenous Peoples Ceremony in Central Park, a coalition that included African Americans, Indigenous peoples from all over the world, Asian Americans, Latino, Chicano, Puerto Rican peoples, white middle class, working class of all hues and ethnicities, and the LGBT community. It was everybody. It was everybody. And it was a tremendous, they estimate, 400,000 people. Changing the politics and posturing around climate change has got to be a number one priority. If we don't do that, we won't have a planet in which to argue about the First Amendment. I also want to just endorse and embrace our sisters and brothers in Hong Kong today. That's what we feel. Of those students in that pro-democracy movement. I want to say that in the last years, tens of thousands of people in this country have marched for immigration rights, have demanded the Dream Act be passed, and have done everything they can to stop the roundup of so-called undocumented people. 1 million people marched in Washington in April 2004 for reproductive freedom. I'm enumerating these things because we get these protests as sound bites on the evening news and then forget that they happened. And then the media says there's no student movement anymore, that people are apathetic, that they're not really organizing. That's not true. Don't believe it. And that's the question that Goldberg was responding to. Don't believe it, and don't let it stop you from engaging in meaningful social justice and peace movements that need to happen. One final comment. There's all these new technologies, like Twitter and smartphones and so on, make possible almost instantaneous communication, and we can see the role of this has played in many protests around the world, including in Hong Kong now, but also in the Arab Spring, all over the world. But I want to emphasize to you that there is no substitution for grassroots, face-to-face, day-to-day, neighborhood-to-neighborhood organizing. There's no substitution for that. That is what inspires people. That is what gets people to understand that their issues that they're concerned about are connected to other issues, that we are all part of one another. Then we can have a vision and propose to people a vision of a world in which there is peace and social justice and great happiness. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you all for coming out. A week ago, if somebody would have asked me what was the most important student protest movement of the last 50 years, I would have confidently said the Berkeley Free Speech Movement. But that was a week ago. On Monday and Tuesday, we were upstage. Probably the most significant student movement of our era is taking place as we speak in Hong Kong. This has been building for over a year. In June, the issue, if those of you who are not reading the newspapers don't know, the issue is the right to free elections. In 2017, the citizens of Hong Kong have been given the right to vote, but with a trick. All candidates have to be approved both by the authorities in Beijing and by the business establishment in Hong Kong. That's very much like the right to vote in Iran. You can vote as long as nobody you vote for wants to change anything or wants to do anything to upset the status quo. Last June, the citizens of Hong Kong held an online referendum on the right to nominate their own candidates. Even though it was hacked by the authorities and was down, over 900,000 people participated in that referendum. Today, October 1st, is a national day in China, and the protests were supposed to start today. But the Hong Kong Federation of Students, which is an organization of all university students in Hong Kong, and Scholasticism, an organization that began as high school activists, jumped the gun and began the Occupy Central on Monday. They were confronted with tear gas and attack, and as a result, all of Hong Kong, other than the party and the business establishment, came to their support. No accurate figures exist, but at least 100,000 people today are sitting in the streets of Hong Kong. They are demanding a change in the way elections happen. They are demanding the executive stand down, and they said if they don't get their demand soon, they will start occupying buildings. I want to read you a statement from the organizers of this rally, but I hope I am speaking for all of you. We support your Occupy movement for free elections and democracy in Hong Kong, and we call for police restraint. University and high school students are leading the way. Today, October 1st, marks the 50th anniversary of the Berkeley Free Speech Movement. Our officials repressed us in 1964, but our struggle for free speech prevailed. Today, we are officially honored and recognized. You will be honored and recognized as well. The whole world is watching. Students around the plaza, they have yellow ribbons that represent this movement. I'm hoping they will get them out. This is their banner. And I want to... This wasn't what I was planning to say today, but I think it was what had to be said today. I think that our movement in Berkeley inspired young people and activists around the world. People were conservative, were tired, were afraid, were isolated before that, and they came together and stood up. The Hong Kong students taking part in a movement that started with Occupy with peace and love, Occupy Central with peace and love, are now setting up another image, another example for the whole world to follow. just when things seem too conservative to make a difference, just when things seem impossible, the opportunity arises. One has to struggle in the conditions you live, but no, when change happens fast. Our world is faced by so many ills that I'm not going to catalog them. But in broad terms, we have the growth of inequality and opportunity for students. You're saddled with such debt that you can't even leave school and think of anything but paying them back. For working people, real wages are lower today than they were in 1964. For people without jobs and without opportunities, the world is a very frightening place. And yet, the pay for corporate executives has skyrocketed. Corporate executives make 3,000 times their average employee. Fast food executives make 1,200 times their average employee. It's not just about money. It's about political power. It's about being able to control this society, and that's got to change. And that is one of the two civilization issues that are facing us. Are we looking forward to a world of opportunity or a return to aristocracy and oligarchy? The second issue of equal importance is the right to live in a livable planet. Climate change, poisoning the environment. We are destroying the life support systems upon which our human civilization is based. And greedy corporate powers don't think about their grandchildren. They only think about the bottom line. And once again, those same people who redistributed wealth on their behalf are refusing to allow the necessary activities to come to a livable planet, to preserve the climate, to preserve the life-giving ecosystems of the world. So we have a huge, huge agenda before us. I'm going to conclude. Think of the students in Hong Kong. Think of the university students. Think of the high school students. Do what you can do day in, day out. We will all come together and we shall prevail. Thank you.
In 1965, things succeeded in getting rid of the ban on political advocacy on campus. In 1969, students established ethnic studies program. This was followed in 1976 with the establishment of women's gender studies. In the 80s, student strikes and mass direct action towards the university spent out more than $3 billion to stop that with the first time.
The irony.
In 2012, strikes and other collective actions helped win a freeze on in-state tuition rates. We will likely need to strike in the coming year to maintain this tuition freeze.
Yes, no.
Just last year, workers struck to ensure the day, and those who come after them could retire in dignity. We struck as well to push the university to support undocumented students, transgender students, and student parents. Last year, students of color also took action to say no to Napolitano when she first visited campus in the spring. If you want to help carry forward these and other struggles this year, please come to the General Assembly at 5:30 this evening in Wheeler Hall. Mario Zavia said that there are times to put our bodies on the line, to put our bodies against the gears of the university. He also said that until we are free, the present moment is one of these times. For all who remain sick at heart at the unfreedom of the university, we can feel that now is still one of those times. Do you feel sick at heart?
Yes. To this rally at 1:30 in the Moss Vice Room, which is 315 Wheeler Hall, the Berkeley Faculty Association will be having a really great panel. So Wendy Brown, Political Science Department, Jerome Hayes, Integrative Biology, Lee Rayford, African American Studies,
classroom you just saw, and Chris Newfield from UC Santa Barbara English Department. They will be talking about the university then and now, and taking a look at some of the same trends that have happened during that time. Following that, the Progressive Coalition students will be holding a panel in the same room. So just go over to the Mark Clay Furman Wheeler, and you'll have it all. Tomorrow night, you're invited to attend the Mario Salvio Memorial Lecture with Sarusha Rahman. She is a restaurant worker, organizer, and the director of the Food Labor Policy Institute here at Berkeley. You hear how the workers supported the students back in 1964. Let's show today's workers that we support them. Come to the workers in this country are building a movement, and they may be out in the street. Let's show them that we are there for them. That will be tomorrow night in Wheeler Auditorium at 8 o'clock. Doors open at 7.
Yes, that's right.
Come get the flyers for the month of resistance. Take them to your fellow students. Take them to your teachers. Sign up. Take an action. Join an action. Say no to police brutality. Say no to mass incarceration.
That's got to be hot, buddy.
You going to take a picture?
Yeah.
Those who believe terror happens to directly and they refuse to accept it, and those who see it happening to others and find that unacceptable.
Yeah, I got you. You can take that thing off, man.
Tell your friends, tell your church, tell your synagogue, tell your Indian club, tell your women's movement friends, tell your fellow students. Let's take an action at UC Berkeley.
I have a small action, short, not small. There's currently an action happening. In that building right there, they were down in your guidance for occupation. We need your support. How progressive goal is it?
Yeah.
Do the mic check thing
and stay on the stage. This is all over there. Like,
trust what you want to see there. We want them to engage in a student and a community process so that we can create an alternative design, something new that better addresses student and worker community needs.
That 20 acres
this current development is entirely out of touch. You'll hear more about that from other folks. Open and transparent and accessible.